it's kind of surreal because you catch yourself at practice and it's like you looking up at the indoor and just realizing that you play for Florida State. Like it says, the national championship years. And it's just like, man, you really have this historical, like, college, you know, this is, it's, I'm just grateful for this experience and this opportunity. I'm glad, you know, glad I was able to make it here. But yeah.
Can I get a tribe check?
What's up, Seminole fans? My name is Emily Peters, and welcome to another episode of Tribe Check. We have a lot to get to, and we're going to get to all things NFL draft. But first, for all my Diamond Sports fans and all my softball people out there, a UNC sweep this weekend, a 4-0 week for our softball girls. Of course, it's great to see you sweep an ACC opponent, but that Florida game was also pretty fun to watch in the midweek. And this weekend, we got Area 51 back. So I know a lot of you guys were excited to see her back out there feeling much better. And of course, Kaylee Harding. I mean, come on. Are you kidding me? Definitely check out those highlights if you weren't able to check out the games this weekend. They were pretty sweet. And the Seminoles are looking good. I think they are starting to figure things out at a good time in the season. And then we transition over to baseball. And of course, yesterday's game was not the most fun to watch. Probably a good thing that it ended a little bit early. Of course, Florida State was run ruled by the Demon Deacons, but they took the series. They secured the series win Friday and Saturday. And you always like to see that after you drop a series, especially an ACC series the week before. And of course, they won their midweek game, against UNF as well. So a 3-1 week for them, 4-0 week for softball. Pretty good week, if you ask me. And for baseball, you saw Ben Barrett out there again. He only threw two pitches, but it's better than zero. And it's just good to see him back out there. So hopefully we get everyone healthy very soon and finish off the year strong. And then hopefully see some good stuff in the postseason. So hopes are high, feeling good. We'll see how the rankings play out today, but a good weekend overall in our Diamond Sports area. And then, of course, transitioning over to football, NFL draft weekend. And if you're watching this, you probably know all of these things already, but we're just going to quickly go over how our Seminoles fared in the NFL draft before I get into today's episode with LT. So this weekend, of course, Thursday kicked us off. Which also I will mention, if you guys are not listening to Hear the Spear, it's Noel Game Day's other podcast, and I went live with them on Thursday, which was really fun. I've never been a guest on a podcast before, nor done a live podcast, so it was definitely a fun experience. And I sat down with Austin Veazey and Dustin Lewis, and we chatted, had a little draft watch party. So that was fun. It was a little long and a little late, I will say, but definitely check them out. If you're not already, they are the best spot. If you are a Seminole fan, it is the best place you can find all of your news. So whether it's listening to the podcast or following them on Twitter, definitely do so. They are the best in the biz for sure. But anyway, Thursday night, of course, we saw Jared Verse, our first round 19th overall pick to the Rams. Definitely exciting to see. And we were having a great time on the podcast on Thursday talking about him and celebrating him being a first round pick finally. So congratulations to Jared Verse. And then we move over to the second round, kicked it off really strong with Keon Coleman going to the Bills. Of course, Josh Allen said that Keon was the one he wanted. So it should be fun to watch this upcoming season, that connection between Josh Allen and Keon Coleman. Keon's got some big shoes to fill, but I think he's the guy for the job for sure. So excited to see him go to the Bills. And then, of course, Braden Fisk to the Rams with Jared Verse. If you have not seen that video yet, it was all over my Twitter of Braden Fisk getting the call. It's emotional. I shed a few tears, especially when you see Braden just break down. It's, oh my gosh, it was a really, really special moment for him, for both of them. And I'm so excited to see them get to play together again over on the West Coast. Super exciting stuff. So congratulations to Fisk and Jared getting to play over there. Of course, Keon with the Bills. And then sort of a surprise in the second round, Renardo Green going to the 49ers. What a cool moment that was, seeing him go off the board. Just really excited for him and wishing him the best. Definitely a happy surprise there. Then round three, of course, we got Trey Benson going to the Cardinals, which was a little bit of a surprise. If you were live with us on Thursday, I was pretty adamant about Benson going to the Cowboys, and arguably maybe he should have, but when do the Cowboys ever do anything they're supposed to? I don't know. But also, after thinking about it a little bit, because at first I was like, ooh, I don't know about that one, but Kyler Murray's got a similar playing style to Jordan Travis regarding the run game. And I don't know, I think he could be utilized well. So, but anyway, just excited for Trey getting the call up and getting the chance to play at the next level. And then, of course, another kind of surprise was Jarian Jones going to the Jags, also in the third round. Very happy surprise. And he's just headed just a hop, skip, and a jump over to Jacksonville, which is super cool. I'm sure he'll be around Tallahassee when he can, since he's so close. And I'm sure a lot of us Seminole fans are happy that he will be not going too far. A lot of guys go into the West Coast, so it's nice to have someone over here. So that'll be fun. That's exciting for him. And then we'll go ahead and skip over to the fifth round with Jordan Travis going to the Jets, which selfishly as a Pats fan does not make me super happy. But for him and getting to play under Aaron Rodgers, just this opportunity and just everything playing out exactly the way it should is the best thing in the whole entire world. I could not be happier for him. And I sort of struggle to find the words to describe just what this means. And I know that's tough in a podcast to not be able to find the words. But I don't know. I think for us Seminole fans, you knew that he deserved this opportunity. And arguably there's not many people that deserve it more. And we know what he's capable of, and it's just such a blessing that he can now share it with the entire world. And I think the NFL knows what he's capable of. The Jets for sure do. And it makes me extremely happy to see him have the opportunity. And I think everything worked out the way it was supposed to. So congratulations to Jordan Travis. I really just could not be happier for him. I guess I could be happier if it wasn't the Jets, but I understand the opportunity. And it's a blessing. It really is. And I'm super excited for him. So anyway, moving on to the sixth round, we got Johnny going to the Eagles. Fly, Johnny, fly, as I said on Twitter. Definitely a good fit for him, just figuratively with, you know, Birdman and his wingspan. Definitely a true Eagle, but just a great experience for him and great to see him go. Definitely deserved it as well. And I'm excited to see how he does in Philadelphia. And then scooting over to the seventh round, we got Jaheim Bell going to the Pats, which made me a very happy girl. I didn't really know. I knew he was kind of talking to the Pats, but I didn't know exactly how he would fit in since we've got a couple of tight ends over there. But who knows how he'll be utilized. They might kind of use him in different ways. So I'm excited to see what he does. Maybe get a Jaheim Bell jersey. I'm due for a new Pats jersey, so it's very nice to have a Knoll on the squad. And then, of course, another really happy surprise was Tatum Bethune going to the 49ers, which, you know, one of those guys where the performance in the combine, you're not exactly sure how it's going to play out and how he'll fare dealing with injuries and whatnot. But he was one of my favorite people I spoke to at Pro Day. He was just like a little kid in a candy store. He was super excited just going through the process, talking about being at the combine and how he was just so excited to be there. It was a dream come true. And of course, it sounds obvious. Of course, it's their dream come true. But I know that this meant the entire world to him. So congratulations to Tatum. And congratulations to those 10 Noles. Then you got Fabo, Akeem, and Deloach, who you feel like got a little bit snubbed. Akeem especially snubbed from the combine as well, but worked out for them with Fabo going to the Chiefs. He'll be playing with Derek Nnadi as well, so that's cool. He's got a Nole there waiting for him. And then Deloach to the Bucks. I'm sure a lot of Florida State fans are very excited to see him go not too far, just down south, and get to play, hopefully, for the Bucks. Get to prove himself, which I definitely think he will. And then Dent, another Seminole, off to the West Coast, over to the Chargers. So congratulations to those three. I know that those teams picked up some real steals in those three guys. So best of luck to them. Now transitioning to today's episode, of course we have Lawrance Toafili, LT, the man himself. He's a redshirt senior from St. Petersburg, Florida. One of my favorite players since he arrived in Tallahassee back in 2020, also the year that Mike Norvell arrived in Tallahassee. So he has been here for the entire Norvell era. He's a guy that has really gained responsibility and really blossomed. You see the Norvell system really work on a guy like Toafili. He was, you know, a big time prospect coming out of high school, but he is just someone that has been steady Eddie for the Seminoles and really progressed well. Of course, we remember that ACC championship. He was the MVP with 118 rushing yards. And then, of course, that 73-yard rush and the game-winning touchdown. He was a true leader, a true veteran in that game, someone who led the Seminoles to that ACC championship. But he's had some really bright moments throughout the years. And we talk about that. We talk about his time at Florida State, some of his favorite memories. He tells us a little bit about the team. I spoke with him right after the spring game, so it was a little bit of a debrief in that sense. And we got some fun questions in there, too. So it was a really fun interview. Thank you so, so much to Derek and Krista for setting it up. I really appreciate it. And of course, LT, thank you for your time. It was a pleasure talking to you. I just had the best time. And again, he's been one of my favorite players since he arrived. So the fan in me was excited to talk to him. And I hope you guys enjoy it just as much as I did. So here is LT. So welcome, Lawrance Toafili, to Tribe Check. LT, it's so great to have you here. I'm excited for the chance to meet you and chat with you, and I just really appreciate you taking some time.
No, for sure. I appreciate you having me over here, you know, chatting it up. I'm glad to be here.
Chatting it up on Tribe Check. That's the plan today. So you just recently had a spring showcase, and I had a chance to be up in the press box kind of watching. I'm sure you know, you've been with the team, you guys have been practicing together all spring, but sometimes you don't really learn things until you're kind of in that game situation. So from your perspective, what are some of the things you kind of learned about the new team?
I mean, we're definitely just getting to know each other. We're gelling, but I definitely know that we have a team that's going to push and they're going to play hard for sure. I mean, even though there's some things that we need to clean up, obviously, but they're going to play hard. You know, like I know we have a team that's going to play for each other.
So talking about the team, I want to get your thoughts. I know you get this question a lot. I was in there for the post game. So, you know, he was right there next to you. So the pressure was on. But DJU, just someone that I think the fans have already really started to fall in love with. From your perspective, playing with him, what is he like and how is he really fitting in?
I mean, he's a great leader. I love the way he comes to work about his business. You know, he's very professional. He's very professional. I feel like he brings the group together. Okay, yeah, no. He brings the group together.
Need you big.
Yeah, I got you. But he made the room. He brings the team together. You know, he has his own way of connecting with everybody. And he's just a great guy. Like, he's a genuine person. Like, you could tell just from talking to him like a couple times, you could tell that he's here and he's he's coming to work and he's going to bring his best for and push everybody to their best as well. So he's a great guy.
I guess like the first impression too with him is like he's kind of like a calm presence, like among chaos. You know, I feel like that's probably something good, you know, in game situations. Like, you know, yes. You kind of have that calm, yes, in the storm. Is that correct?
Yes, yes, indeed. He brings everybody up. You know, he's a guy that brings everybody up, and he just kind of keeps everybody with a level head as well. Like, you know, he's very calm, but he keeps everybody else's head pretty level as well. He tries his best to.
Yeah, I'm sure it's a difficult task sometimes with all you guys.
Yeah, it is crazy.
So as one of the veterans now of the running back committee, I want to get your thoughts on some of the newcomers, specifically Roydell Williams, someone who automatically just really stands out. I think fans are already very excited about him. What makes him special?
I mean, he brings that size to the group as well. He's one of those size guys, but he can fly. You know, he's fast. He's very versatile as well. You know, he can make some moves too. Him and Kazaya, you know, we got a great room. I'm not going to lie, but Roydell specifically, I mean, he brings that big, you know, pass blocker and, you know, big hitter to that running back room. So, yeah, I'm glad to have him. You know, he's special.
Can't really talk size without mentioning Cam either. I mean,
yeah.
Is he actually a freshman? I don't know.
I had to check that guy's birth certificate.
Yeah, 100%. You too. I mean, you've spent a lot of time in the off season really like putting on the pounds with Coach Storms, and he's really come in and built you guys up. I mean, you know, what have you been up to?
Yeah, we built by Storms, man. You know, we come in there to work every day, just like we do on the football field.
That's, yeah, plain and simple. I love to see what he's doing with you guys. And you know, hearing from Coach Norvell too, hearing like you yourself are playing some of the best football since you've gotten here. So, you know, what has allowed you to kind of get to that point?
I mean, honestly, it's more of experience. I feel like I've grown so much as a person and as a player. It's just everything's kind of slowed down for me now. I kind of understand the game. I understand our scheme and I understand what we're trying to do. So I feel like that's the main thing that kind of like, you know, helped the game. Like, well, the experience is kind of what helped me.
Yeah, we're definitely,
you know, to that level.
Yeah, your experience and your growth and kind of how your role has evolved throughout your time at Florida State. But just a little bit more about this new team that you got. Obviously, everyone knows that the 2023 team was so incredibly special. First, before we talk about the new team, what did it mean to you to be a part of that group?
I mean, it was a very special group of people. We were very, very close. You know, it was a lot of old guys there that like have been here for a while, and you know, they kind of like kept the team close together. So, you know, we're a very close-knit team. And I'm just glad to be able to be a part of that, you know, be able to be a part of that season and just a part of that team, man, you know, some great guys.
It's tough with like the sentimental value going into a new year. Like, okay, how do we kind of match that? And I guess you kind of go into it not trying to be like another team. Now you're a different team. So what makes this different team just as special and different?
I mean, this team, I hadn't have like a team to where everybody's kind of like, I don't know, so quick. We got together so quick, and it's kind of like a lot of new people and new faces and coming in our program. We kind of got them like buying in and just figuring out like the standard and how we operate. That's kind of just, it's been very smooth. Like, I feel like it's been a smooth transition, and I feel like this team works really hard. Like, I can't say that. Like, I know we got a hardworking team that wants to be better in all aspects. So we're growing closer day by day, and I feel like we got a special team.
Why do you think that is, like, the gel together so quickly? Is it, you know, the work ethic? Is it the coaching staff? Like, what kind of caused that?
I kind of feel like it's the want to. Like, you know, we just want to. We want to be better. You know, last year's team kind of set the standard. So it's like we have to, you know, hit the standard every day. And that's just a part of how we operate.
Yeah, it's a standard. So I want to get into you a little bit. I know kind of growing up, you looked up to players like Warwick Dunn, Deion Sanders, just kind of a Nole for life type of thing, which is really special. You finally get to put on that garnet and gold back in 2020. What did it mean to you, I guess, when you finally were like, okay, I'm committing to Florida State and I'm going to play at Doe Campbell?
I mean, it meant everything. It was a dream of mine. I was just so happy to be able to. It's kind of surreal because you catch yourself at practice and it's like you looking up at the indoor and just realizing that you play for Florida State. Like it says, the national championship years. And it's just like, man, you really have this historical like college, you know, I'm just grateful for this experience and this opportunity. I'm glad I was able to make it here. But yeah, proud of myself for that. And, you know, we got a lot more work to do. So yeah.
Of course. Well, just like Norvell says, it's a climb. It's not done. But your journey has been a little bit unique in the sense where, you know, you did come in 2020, yeah, that weird like COVID year. And it was the start of Coach Norvell's tenure at Florida State. So take us through kind of the journey that you've been on with Coach Norvell. Because, you know, I've heard from like a couple other former players, just listening to them on podcasts and whatnot, and just kind of the ups and downs and finally kind of getting to this spot where you are setting a standard.
Yeah, like, oh, man, it's been a long journey, I would say. First getting here, Norvell came in and he didn't have a lot of time to recruit. I was already committed. I stayed committed. He gave me a phone call and was like, yeah, we'd love to have you. So I was just happy to, you know, be accepted to the new coaching staff, and I was ready to get to work. Came. It was a lot of running backs when I first came, honestly. But a lot of the guys kind of, you know, it came down to a few guys. It came down to like five guys, you know, and those five guys I got very close with and learned a lot from. LaDamian Webb and Jayshon Corbin and their times here. I learned a lot from guys and learned how to basically kind of handle myself. You know, I kind of implemented some of the things that they did into my own, you know, in my own way. But that first year, it was pretty tough. We had a tough year. We were putting in the work, though. So it was slowly but surely. I knew it was going to happen. But it was a lot of work that we had to do and a lot of things that we had to fix with the culture and the environment. So once, I feel like after the first year, we had a tough year. The second year, you kind of see the improvement. We still didn't really get over the hump. It was a lot of things we had to clean up. But the third year, it was just like, you know, it was us basically understanding and learning the standard and being able to operate like at a high level. So and that's all aspects. Like that's when it comes to school, when it comes to, you know, off the field, everything, just in life in general and as individuals, and that will collectively kind of help the team progress, I feel like. And every year, that third year, we kind of seen a breakthrough with all the work and all the things that we learned and all the experiences. We kind of like learned from all of it and just put it together And then after that, you know, like it was just only upward. It was a climb, I would say. So we kind of just got together and pushed even harder. And I mean, that's what led us to a great season last year. So we just got to keep that process going. I feel like as long as everybody's understanding what we're trying to do and the level that we have to operate, I feel like we're going to be in a good spot.
You mentioned that third year, you kind of start to see the results and you start to see it. Okay, like this is what we're working towards. It's starting to work. Was there a moment during that season for you that you were like, oh, shoot, we're kind of good?
I mean, during that season, I just seen how fast we were playing. I mean, it wasn't so much like anybody else. I kind of seen it within the team, like the competition was getting way better within each other. Like we were playing so hard at practice. It felt like practice was more hard than the game, if I'm being honest with you. Like, the game was kind of more chill than practice because of the atmosphere that we create at practice. So I felt like once I seen how we handled practice and how we operated at a very high level, and that's what kind of showed that improvement. I mean, that's where we made the improvement at, and being more mature, I would say, as well. Like, less flags and penalties and things like that. So mm-hmm. I feel like all that played a role into us, you know, getting to that level, I would say.
You mentioned some of the other running backs that you guys gelled together your first year. Probably some people that you looked up to too. But you're in your second senior season, so you're the big dog now and the veteran guy that a lot of these guys probably look up to. I mean, even the transfers coming in, it's like, you know, you've been through this. You know how mm-hmm. about your business and whatnot. How has that leadership role been like for you?
I mean, it's been cool because I've been able to learn from it as well. Like, just me making sure that them guys know everything is also keeping me sharp on my stuff. But I would say, like, vocally, it's made me become more vocal. Like, it made me become a more vocal person, because when I first came, I was a quiet guy. You know, I handle my business. You know what I mean? I try to stay out of everybody else's, and I'm just a hard worker, and I kind of lead by example. So me transitioning into this role to where I'm more of a talkative person and I'm interacting more with teammates, I feel like it just made me grow, like, and socially. And that's something that it helps. It involves leadership skills. So it's kind of like, it like plays hand in hand. And I'm just grateful for that. You know, I'm happy to be the leader. I mean, happy to lead these guys, and I'm happy to have these guys with me on this journey, because they've taught me so much stuff. You know, they're leaders too in their own way. So, like, we definitely have something good going in there, and I'm glad to, you know, take up that responsibility for that room.
I'm sure it's somewhat easy to lead most of these guys.
Yeah. No, those we got some good guys in there, man. You know, some hard workers. So mm-hmm. And guys are ready to learn. It's not really, yeah, it's a good room, good environment.
Nice. So another dimension of your role is just kind of on the field. You know, you've had more responsibility each year. Specifically going back to that ACC championship game, do you feel like, I feel like it's easier to kind of lead and be vocal when you just know, like, you have the confidence going for you. Do you feel like that game in particular maybe, like, unlocked another kind of level of confidence and leadership in you?
I mean, if I'm being honest with you, I was just trying to win. I was just trying to make sure everybody know, like, hey, we're going to win. Like, you know what I'm saying? Everybody keep that mindset. Like, that was my main focus the whole game. I wasn't even expecting to kind of like for all that to happen. You know, I wasn't even expecting to get the MVP, but I'm happy it went that way. And I'm happy, you know, happy those things happened. I'm grateful for it. But I would say, like, I guess it did help me give some confidence for that role, but I wasn't really too much worried about it, I would say. I was just trying to help the team win, and that's kind of how things played out.
It's always interesting hearing from, like, you guys' perspective, because yeah. I talked to Kaylee Mudge from the softball team a couple weeks ago, and in one of their Women's College World Series games, she went, like, 5 for 5. She's just killing it. And she was like, I asked her about it, and she was like, I had no idea. I just felt like I had been on base a lot. And it's funny because us over here, we're like, wow, like, he's doing all of these things, but you guys are, we're just trying to win.
That's what I'm saying. Like, exactly. It's not on my mind thinking about that, but, you know, looking back on it, it kind of does give me that confidence. Well, it helped give me that confidence in that moment. You know, I was just ready for the opportunity, though. I feel like it just came and I was ready for it. So
many more in your way, for sure. So we're excited. I want to ask you a few fun questions. This one is kind of personal, and I didn't preface you for this, so I'm interested to hear what you say. But back in high school, I saw there was an article about you and your father and your Samoan culture, just kind of how that's a part of you and the influence. Yeah. I'm interested, do you still kind of exercise anything or like wear anything to kind of celebrate that culture?
I mean, I always have something going on with that culture. I mean, that's how I grew up. Like growing up, I was always in that atmosphere. Like I did a lot of luau's. I did a lot of dances. Like they got a men's hula. I did the men's hula. We did like a fire knife. It's all type of things going on. And I still always try to keep up with that. You know, I try to keep up with being on top of it, like, you know, being able to spin the knife. I play the ukulele sometimes. So like it's different things that I always do in that culture. And I have lava lavas. Like that's the little thing I was wearing in the pictures, mm-hmm. in those pictures that you seen with me and my dad. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was wearing, I have those at the house that I wear sometimes. It's kind of like a robe thing, you know, that the guys wear. But yeah, I'm always involved with the culture. Yeah, incorporating it somehow.
Cool. We'll have to see some of those dance moves at some point. Be a touchdown. So
maybe, yeah. Dance maybe moves. So. Actually, you're right. Maybe I should pull out a little.
Yeah, it'd be good luck. I'll have to pull up that picture and put it over when you're talking about it so everyone can see what you're talking about. But that's awesome. I love that. And your dad was also like a huge influence on you, I'm sure, like football wise, you know, kind of growing up with a role model like him.
Yeah.
What's kind of his advice to you right now?
I mean, it's kind of weird because he never made it to this level, but his advice right now is just, you know, he's always trying to help me get better. You know, he's always trying to help me learn something. And that's kind of what his advice to me is. Just be a sponge, you know, just keep learning and keep growing. And like, you know, that's how you get bigger, stronger and faster. And, you know, that's kind of like all you really focus on. Kind of don't look too far ahead, you know.
Right.
That's kind of his. Yeah.
Day by day.
Yeah. Exactly.
Spoken like a true athlete day by day.
Yeah.
So, you know, in game, I joke, I don't know if you're paying attention to this because you're like in game, like you said, but sometimes the video board will have these really awesome videos for you guys, kind of personalized, like, hey, look, it's Lawrance Toafili. And there's like a really like hype song playing and it's all your highlights. We call them sizzles. Not sure if you're familiar. But okay. So we're making your sizzle. This is theoretical. We're making your sizzle. What song should be on your highlights?
That's a tough question because I don't know. I like a lot of songs right now.
It's hard to narrow it down to one. I agree.
I could pick an artist. I don't know. It depends on what the video would look like, but I probably would go like a Young Boy song, maybe some type of Young Boy song. Cause like, you know, he just kind of, he sets the mood, you know what I mean?
So,
Young Boy song. Yeah.
I think this is one that the fans enjoy. I generally ask it, what's your favorite food spot in Tallahassee?
I'm not gonna lie, Sir Chiro's is
really? Pretty.
Yeah, I've been going there a lot lately. I don't know if I would say it's my favorite, but right now it's pretty popular for me. But over
Chipotle.
Say it again.
Over Chipotle.
Oh yeah, Sir Chiro's kind of got me over Chipotle right now, man. I'm not gonna lie. But other than that, I would say, if you're going for like chicken wings or something like that, I would say A-Town. I don't know. A-Town wings, their wings are pretty good. Those are probably like my two main spots that I hit a lot. Yeah, I would say those are two main spots, my go-tos.
Awesome. Go-tos right there. Shout out to those places. Cool. Well, I only have a few more for you, so we'll not take too much more of your time.
No, you're good.
Going back to the football field, you know, we hear a lot about a lot of some of the guys, you know, Cam Davis, like we talked about. I want to get your, and I don't think it's necessarily a sleeper, but I want to get who you think is going to be like, ooh, like they might shock some people because people aren't really talking about them yet, but.
I would say Sam Singleton. Yeah, he's a good player. Like, yeah, he's in the running back room. They're not talking about him too much right now, but he's learning a lot, and he's growing. Like, he's progressing, and I like how he looked this spring. I feel like he's gonna shock some people, honestly. Yeah.
Good stuff. All right, and then what so far? Because your career's not over yet at Florida State. What so far has been your favorite memory? You can take some time to think about that one. I know it could be tough.
I mean, I would say one of my favorite memories would be the 2021 season where we beat Florida and the field got you know, people rushed the field. That was pretty cool. But it's kind of tough because I just love the ACC championship game. Like, even without the MVP, I just love winning that game just to, you know, finish off the season the way that we did for Jay Trout. That was a good moment for me. It was a happy moment, you know.
Special.
I feel like that's one that I'll never forget. Like, it always replays, like, you know what I'm saying? So, yeah, I would say that too. Those two
moments. For all of us watching, and I know for you guys as a team, it's just, yeah, very, very special.
It was nice.
Well, that's a good note to leave it on. LT, it's so great to meet you. I really appreciate you taking some time to chat with me today, and I wish you the absolute best of luck for the upcoming season.
No problem. Thank you. I appreciate you for having me, man. I appreciate you for everything.
Of course. Feel the bando up with bass, get a little bro them a job. You can come get rich with us, you gon' eat or you gon' starve. Keep it certified, hear the sin I pay, I'm not.